Hello everyone. It is with great pleasure that I welcome you to today's webinar on climbing the ladder of leadership with IEEE Power Electronic Society, hosted by IEEE Power Electronic Society Student Bank Chapter Unisdom Moratuwa, Sri Lanka. Let me introduce our guest speaker today, President of IEEE Power Electronic Society, Professor Frede Blaabjerg. Thank you, sir, for taking time out and joining us today. With that, I would like to invite Ramdima Hasanti, the Chairman of IEEE Power Electronic Society Student Bank Chapter Unisdom Moratuwa, to welcome the gathering.
Hello, everyone. As the founder chairman of IEEE Power Electronic Society, Student Bank Chapter of the University of Moratuwa, Sri Lanka, it's my special duty to give you all a great welcome to this IEEE PELS Day 2020 webinar. It's a great day when we have been planning and ready for it. First and foremost, I would like to welcome a remarkable character for this occasion. He would be the guest speaker for today's webinar, Professor Frede Blaabjerg, the President of IEEE Power Electronics Society. He is a professor of power electronics and drives at Aalborg University, Denmark, and is also the Vice President of Danish Academy of Technical Sciences. Professor Freddy has received 32 IEEE Prize Paper Awards, the IEEE PELS Distinguished Service Award in 2009, the IEEE PEMC Council Award in 2010, the IEEE William E. Nevis Power Electronics Award in 2014, and in recently, the IEEE Edison Medal in 2020. He has published more than 600 journal papers in the field of power electronics and its applications. He is a co-author of 4 monographs and editor of 10 books in power electronics and its applications. We are proud to have you here, sir, and we are waiting to be inspired by your thoughts, dear professor. Next, dear participants, I'm thankful for your presence today and welcome you all with a warm heart. I hope you all will have an inspiring time today.
Thank you. Yes, so thank you for the invitation to give this this lecture this afternoon. As it was said, my name is Frede Blaabjerg, and I am the IEEE Power Electronic Society President. This is something we are for a certain period. And I am the president for 2019 and 2020. And also, thank you very much for the chapter here to organize this event. This is highly appreciated from the society, and also despite all the issues we have with virus, pandemic, and so on, that you are able to organize this. And I'm very happy to be here this this afternoon. So the title of today is about IEEE and IEEE Power Electronic Society, to try to give you some insight into how it's organized, and also, for example, what we are offering for students, and hopefully give you some inspiration also for what you can be working with in the future for yourself, but also for your chapter. So, just let me introduce a little bit our technology. I have to say, I have been active now in IEEE for many years, and I must say the power electronics technology becomes every day more and more important, and it is applied in so many applications, and we also see in the future that it becomes a really major component in our energy system. We have here a classical system, we can say more or less, as we have a power system. This is generating electricity, and we have transformers transmitting, distributing power, and then we have a lot of different applications at the end user side. Appliances, LEDs, many different applications where we consume power. And now the more modern power system is also getting wind turbines, photovoltaics, storage, not so many fuel cells, but still a technology available. And in the last years, we have to say that also the transportation is becoming electrified. So that all together indicates that that we are really using a lot of electricity. And for almost all possible cases we can imagine in terms of production, in terms of consumption, we are applying the power electronics technology. So this is shown with those bricks here. You can see where there are power electronics. Sometimes we do AC to DC, sometimes we do AC to DC to AC, and so on and so on. But in many, many, many applications, we, in terms of electrification, we are applying power electronics. And what comes more on that is that we are also seeing that what we call the classical power station, which are based on fossil fuel, they are becoming taken out of operation, and instead we are building a lot of wind turbine generation and photovoltaic generation. Today, 70% of all new installed power capacity in terms of generation is renewable in the world. So this is just saying that this is moving in a very, very fast pace. If we take the power electronics technology, well, we can say that we have more than 100 years of history. And here is a timeline that in the beginning, this was mostly what we call vacuum tube, pyrotron, mercury arc rectifier, which was doing some power conversion. And they were robust, but they were also big and so on. But they could do some of the things we wanted to do. Sorry?
Hello.
I just continue. But in 57, this was the big invention in terms of the invention of the thyristor, and there it became possible in a very, very compact way to control power, turn on a component, and then it was conducting. Of course, we know a thyristor needs some voltage to be turned off, reverse-wise, but this was really a dramatic change of how electrical power conversion was done. And then from 57 up to the mid-70s, well, we had the power diodes and a lot of things were going, but then the more fast-reaching semiconductor devices came, and that was the power bipolar transistor, that was the MOSFET, that was also DTO when we go up in power. The next breakthrough came in the 80s with the invention of the IGBT, where a combination of the bipolar transistor and the MOSFET was seen, and this was also really shrinking the size. And then we can say, if we continue the history line, that in the early 2000s, the first samples of what we call wide bandgap devices, as the silicon carbide diodes, they came on the market, and it was possible to see the benefit of wide bandgap devices. And today, when we are working in this area with silicon carbide, MOSFET, JFETs, BJTs, gallium nitride, power devices, and so on, we see really a fantastic evolution of, even the revolution we can talk about in terms of this. In general, you can say a lot of power electronics is, development is, of course, driven by the components we are applying. And if they become better, we can also do many smart things. So if we take in terms of the power electronic itself, yeah, in the beginning, phase one, as we call it here, there we use the switches as nonlinear elements, and we could have some certain circuit operation. But then since the invention of the thyristor, a lot of topologies came, a lot of modeling and control methods came. We could reduce losses, we could reduce the gate driving need, so it became cheaper. And then in the 70s, things became digital control, so the digital world came more and more in order to do very precise control. And if we look at it now, and maybe also some years back, as 10, 15 years back, it's hard to see really the new innovations in terms of circuit. It's much more application-driven, application-improved, power electronic design, packaging, thermal management, reliability, the possibility to scale topologies, modularization, and of course, putting a lot of digital things into the applications, and have a structure where you can also do condition monitoring, that you can do adaptive control, and so on. So this is 100 years of history, and today, which is the PELS Day, we are celebrating that the Power Electronics Society became established. This was on this day by the central administration of IEEE, and this was around 33 years ago. So even though the power electronics was invented in 57, the Power Electronics Society first came in 33 years. And the main reason was that other societies also took the power electronics technology into their domain. But the IEEE as such, this is absolutely one of the biggest professional organizations where we look at where the goal is to advance innovation and excellence in order to improve the benefit for and improve the human life. And IEEE is really a global, as we are in all countries. And the Power Electronics Society is one out of 38 societies in the IEEE organization. And today we have more than 10,000 members, and I hope most of you are members. If not, then I will absolutely encourage you to become a member of the IEEE Association and also IEEE Power Electronics Society. And if you're a student, you can do that for a very low fee. So if we look at leadership and so on, then we can say that the office we have there is that I'm the president. I introduced also my term. Last year in November, December, the president elects, the next president was elected. So he has 1 year to get introduced to being a society president. So this is Liu Qianqiang. And then the president I took over from was Alan Mantu, so he is now junior past president. And the president before that was Abraham Ferreira, you also can see on this slide. But beyond that, as the organization is a little bit organized towards the activities we have, then we have a certain number of vice presidents. And the vice presidents are in technical operation, Jan Fei Lu, products, Brad Lehmann, products, these are, for example, the journals and so on. Global relations, this is Mario Pagas, conferences, Liu Qianqiang, membership, J.J. Liu, standards, Johan Enslin, and treasurer, this is Jan Sun. The treasurer is the person who takes care of the money and do budgeting and follow in how things are evolving in terms of the society. So, if you are a member of the IEEE Power Electronics Society, then you will get both in printed form, electronic form, and also by digital subscription, the IEEE Power Electronics magazine. So I really hope you have had a chance to look at. We spent quite a lot of efforts to present the power electronics technology and how it's evolving, and in a good understanding way, as well as we are also trying to promote in this magazine what is going on in the chapters and so on around the world, conferences and so on. But beyond that, we offer a good range of publications. Our main publication is the IEEE Transactions on Power Electronics, which we own 100%. We share with Industry Application Society, the IEEE Journal of Emerging and Selected Topics of Power Electronics. We are also a part of the IEEE Electrification Magazine, and there are a couple more transactions we are part of, but not media. And then in October 2019, we opened a new journal called IEEE Open Journal Access, the IEEE Open Access Journal of Power Electronics. And the philosophy here is that the authors, they pay to get it published, and then yourself, as everybody, can just download it. So it's an open access journal. So if you have never been at the website of this journal, try to do that, and you can download all the papers which are available there, because the author has paid to have it there. So all the expenses have been covered by the author. And this we see more and more, that things are becoming open access. I also have to mention that, and this is also an indication about the power electronics technology, that for a couple of years, the IEEE Transactional Power Electronics has been the most downloaded publication in IEEE Explorer. Only in the last years, it has been taken over by the journal called IEEE Access. And IEEE Access is also an open access journal like the one I mentioned before. And so the I have been editor-in-chief of the IEEE Transactional Power Electronics. And at that time, we published, I think it was 5,000, 4,000, 5,000 pages per year. The page budget for this year is 13,500 pages, and next year is 10% higher. So this is really indicating that our technology is under really rapid development. But if you are a member, then there are also a lot of other benefits, and where you can, of course, you can attend conferences and workshops. This one here could be called a small workshop or something like that. And you have access to that. And also, if you have the possibility to attend some of the activities, then there are special discounts in terms of attending if you are a member of the IEEE Power Electronics Society. We also have what we call a resource center, and this is a library where it's possible to download a lot of different recorded events. And if you are the Power Electronics Society member, then you are also allowed to access this free of charge. So all webinars which are done there, newsletters, proceedings, conference presentation videos, and slides, roadmaps, and so on, they are available at this resource center. If you are active and want to be active and hear what's going on, then you can also volunteer yourself for technical committees. Here are listed 7. I will come a little bit back to that later, because I'm for the moment expanding that, because I want to have it so that everybody who are interested in working in power electronics, they should be sure that they can see themselves in a technical committee. But to be honest, if I think about it, of course the journals, publications are there, but what is really making a difference is that the IEEE is a very good platform for doing networking. And the Power Electronics Society has more than 170 chapters worldwide, and both classical chapters but also student branches. And I'm very, very happy in Sri Lanka you have been able to establish this. This is a very great achievement, and I hope this will also be a platform to do networking. Now, there are many restrictions globally to be too many together, but I'm quite sure this will open up again. And you can, of course, also do networking through the through meetings like we have here today. But then we also have an organization called Young Professionals, and they are also making special networking events at our conferences, for example, at APEC, ECCE, SPEC, COMPEL, PEDD. So if you have a chance to visit some of those conferences, then look for this event with the Young Professionals. But yes, you can then also, as things are evolving, be part of technical committees, like you saw before, conference committees, in order to organize conferences and so on, chapters. And we also have a special focus on seeing if we can get more women active in the engineering programs, and especially electrical engineering. So that means we have an organization who is who also have special focus for that. Everybody are welcome, but of course we hope also women are interested to do that. And there, typically, we have social gatherings and other events. And some of the new things we have established is what we call mentorship events, and that is that at a table like you see here to the right. You are able to meet some of the volunteers, you are able to meet some of the top professors, top industry people, and discuss with them aspects about how to develop your career. And this we also typically do at those conferences which are listed above. We also have a distinguished lecture program, and there's a chapter. You can ask them to come. You organize the visit, but they get support for the travel from the society. And the distinguished lecture program, yeah, people are nominated, and then they serve as a distinguished lecture for 2 years, and then new ones are coming in. And here you can see some names, and just today, also on the PELS Day, there is an event in Brazil where 8 distinguished lecturers is continuously doing lectures the whole day, and many of the names you see here, they are also doing presentation in parallel with this activity. So this is one example, but it could also be that you invited them to, maybe you invited some of the names here who come to Sri Lanka and then do presentations. We have education and student activities also, where there are competition, and we provide private grants, student private grants to conferences. So if you have a paper and you want to go and present it, then we have the possibility to support that based on an application to the conference. But we also have a competition where students are working in teams globally, and every year we now announce a new competition. This year it's about a satellite. I can't remember what it is next year. But then the best proposal are invited to come to APEC, and then there is a final presentation at ECGE during 1 year. And everything is benchmark according to some specifications. The mentorship program I have been around. But we are also doing the people who are, I have a competition for people who have done their PhD phases, and there we have what we call a PhD phases talk award, and the idea is that the PhD students, after they have graduated, they do a 300 seconds, and that's of course 5 minutes presentation about their PhD project, and show their results in an entertaining way so they are convincing. And there we are then giving, I think it's 3 awards for the best submissions. And this year we have received, I think it's around 35 or 40 proposals of this PhD Thesis Talk Award. So this is also a possibility for you to be a part of. We also do standards. IEEE in general has a very long tradition to be driving standards in a lot of fields, for example, in mobile communication, data communication, and power engineering and so on. And also in the power electronics, we are setting up standards and roadmaps. We have just done a complete new roadmap on wide bandgap devices, which can be downloaded. But we also have activities on power hardware in the loop, smart grids, fault current limiting testing, and also on passive components. And of course, if it is the case and they are overlapped with some other societies, and that could typically be the case, then we also work together with them. And then people like you and the whole world, they can say they want to take part of this standard development. And there is a process in order to make those standards before we can say they are recommended practice for the whole IEEE organization. But sometimes such events can gather 100, 200 people, both industry and academia. So that can be quite interesting to join. As I told you, the Power Economy Society is one out of 38 societies. And then the IEEE has another organization called Community. So we are society, but you can also make a community. And the community is where, let's say, an area where you're not too a society because you overlap too much with too many societies. So you can make a community in order to try to, let's say, promote a kind of technology. And the IEEE Power Electronics Society is home society for the electrification community, transportation electrification community. And here are some examples of what that can be. And of course, you can see that this is also a very, very important field. And you can also imagine that many societies are contributing to that in the IEEE. So, this is a way to, let's say, improve your career and create the future. And what we all the time try to do is to come with some of exciting, let's say, opportunities for you. And so you can do network, you can improve your career and so on and so on. So if you're already part of the Power Electronics Society, please, I will really say that you it's a good idea to do this. And here are the, in IEEE headquarters is based in U.S., close to New York. And we have six staff people who are helping to run journals, who are helping to run conferences and all kinds of meetings. But let me just also, as the students have to be here, say a little bit about the PELS student and young professionals, because there is also an organization around that in order to, let's say, do activities and encourage chapters to do things, and of course also to do network, and as they say here, a place to mingle with power electronic peers and have fun. So. So this is for sure. So some of the things being done are receptions, doing digital products, as we call it, and of course also facilitate the student chapters. And if you take the young professional reception, I have been a little bit around it. They are held at the big conferences, also the Southern Hemisphere Power Electronic Conferences. And typically there are some speakers who are starting, like I do here today, but I'm not speaking too long time. They are not speaking too long time. They are maybe 5-10 minutes about their career experience. And then there is the possibility to get a little bit to drink and eat, and then try to mingle and discuss with peers about many different things, and maybe even and discuss about the presentation which has been done at this young professional meeting. And so here are two examples with that, so you can see that quite a large amount of people attending that. There have also been receptions more overseas compared with U.S. and ECC Asia, COVID SPEC in Brazil, TECI I can't remember where it is, and TSDIE, which has all this, I think this is in I don't know. I'm not sure. But if there are conference organizations, typically we are asked if we are also supporting that, and most often we are supporting such kinds of activities. And here are some of the planned events for 2020, and it has already been one time in India. But as you know, we had to go. We had to cancel APEC. ECC Europe is not certain yet, but there will also be something. There should be something. Then we have ECC North America in Detroit, E-Grid in Akron, ECC Asia in Nanjing, and then SPEC in Fiji. All those places, if you are going there, and if it is possible to go there, there will also be such kinds of events like you see here. But the young professionals, they also have a seminar range, webinars, and the idea is, of course, for the young professionals to hear from some of the specialists about different things. It could also be the young professionals who are doing it, but here you can see there are two webinars, and typically they are recorded, so they are possible to download if you're a Power Electronics member. But the idea is that about one webinar per month is to be done, and if somebody wants to do a webinar and present at the webinar, then you can see there is a contact person here which is listed, and that's a totally free access for PELS members because it's recorded. student chapters. There have been done a good amount of work to expand with more student chapters. Region 9 have had the highest increase, but in general we seem to have a good growth. And because this technology is really so important, there are so many who are working in it. So it is really possible to gather many people together in the power electronics by such student branches. So if you're aware, if there are some attendees at this event here, who are not associated with a student branch, maybe from another university or something like that, then I'll encourage you to consider today do a student branch. And if you want to do a student branch, look at this Naraya, the writer, she is in charge of that. And here we have formed a team to do the young professional. Harris, and you can see the name here, and there's even an advisory board with some people who have a long experience by doing the young professional. So please try to be volunteer, and I think you'll have great fun and get a very good network. So a little bit about climbing in terms of career. So I have tried to list here how I see IEEE and how I have used IEEE. So I have been member of IEEE in more than 35 years, and it started that I was inspired by a lecture when I was doing my master course, and he told there was he was the latest research in those journals and so on. So I became student member there. And if I then should try to line up what happened then along in respect to IEEE and PELS, then I attended the first PELS conference, presented a paper. This was PESC in 91 and in MIT in the US. And there I could easily see that this was a very, very good possibility for doing networking. Then I think the next step was, it was that I did my first publication in journals. At that time, it was so that you submitted by paper, as a hard copy, to the editor. Then the editor sent, I think the editor sent 5 copies of the paper. Then the editor by mail sent out to reviewers, and then they sent back comments by paper, and then you got the reviews back by paper. So at that time, it was very much more time consuming compared to today, where we have everything in manuscript central. Then the next, when you get a little bit reputation, you also become reviewer, and I think many of you, if you have tried to submit a paper, then you have also been invited to be a reviewer, but that was some of the same things happening. Then I was invited to become a chairman at a conference, one of the PELS conferences, attended workshops, like you saw there, but then it also came to my mind that why not try to organize a workshop, because as in the society, and so that was, I think, the next happen. And I have been so fortunate, as mentioned in the introduction, I have got some awards, and that was the next happening with papers and so on. And I became more brave and said, okay, it makes sense for me also to organize conferences. So that's I organized a small conference in, I think it's around 2000. And time was going, and the natural step after being reviewer is to become associate editor, and that was my next task I think I had in the society. And I would say as an associate editor, I truly have had 8 years of experience before I could become that. And I even think at that time I was also a full professor. You can volunteer to also do conferences, special sessions and so on. And I did that also, so be part of the conference planning. And if you're there, also do a large conference. And I did that in 2007, where more than 1,000 people came, or close to 1,000 people come to Aalborg, where we organized IEEE 2007. And my visibility and our visibility in Aalborg was positive, and the society asked me if I could be the editor-in-chief of the transactions on power electronics. And I became that for 6-7 years, And I that was the time where we went from mailing as a email to management central, so everything became internet-based. And that made a huge difference in terms of operating a journal. So after such activity, and I came higher and higher in the IEEE Power Electronics Society, then also I was asked if I want to be volunteer for ADCOM, and ADCOM is the administrative committee of the IEEE Power Electronics Society. And every year, six are elected by the members to be a member of ADCOM. And that I became, I think, around when I was also editor-in-chief of the Power IEEE Transaction on Power Electronics. And when you are a member of ADCOM, then you can also, by ADCOM, be elected to be vice president. And you remember the photos I introduced with before. And so that means ADCOM, they vote for the vice president. I was vice president for all the products, so that means all the digital things, but also the journals, and try to let that move on. And then last but not least, now I'm the president in the IEEE Power Electronics Society, and the people who can be president have to be in ADCOM one way or the other. So this is the way, to climb in hierarchy in the Power Electronics Society. And there's no doubt, as I have been moving on this ladder, I have also, got a better possibility for my career at the university. I have been able to get higher positions. And then in general, I would say all these activities here have given me so big, huge network. So I would say 95% of all my friends are coming from this society. And it makes me very happy when I go to conference and meet the old friends there. Just an organizational overview about the Power Electronics Society. You can see I'm here as a president. And then I have, you saw some of the treasurer, the senior past president, the immediate past president, and then the president-elect, right? And then we have the members of LAS who are running out in 20, 21, 22. You are elected for 3 years, so you can see the people here. And then we have the technical operation, where there are activities, we have products. This is where all the journals are, conferences. IEEE Power Electronics Society is active in more than 30 conferences every year. So, of course, now we are under pressure because of the pandemic situation, but we try, of course, and we are doing more and more virtual in terms of that. Then we have activities on membership, for example, also towards chapters. We have the standards. We have global relations. We have something with bylaws, and there are some other committees which can be formed by the society president like me. And then we have finally the administrative staff, and that was the focus you saw of those six people who are helping the IEEE Power Electronics Society to make it running. I told you that I will touch a little bit the technical committees, because this is a place also to meet peers in the field. And in the past we had seven technical committees, but now I have had approval to make 12 technical committees. And the idea is that all of you should be able at least to find yourself in one technical committee. So it's control and monitoring of power electronics and components and integration with heat, price, automation, transportation systems, sustainable energy. Then we have one which we call emerging power electronic technologies, and we can say that this is where all the rest, this is what the rest is not covering. Then we have something called critical power and energy storage system, electronic power grid system, wireless power transfer, design methodologies, a little bit in control and modeling, but more broad, aerospace power, and then energy access and off-grid systems. Maybe there are some we are missing, but then at least it's possible to be active in what we call the emerging power electronic technologies. So this is an opportunity for you also to be a member of that, and every of those TCs, as we call them, technical committees, they have a chairman, they are elected by the members of the technical committees, and they of course also have a term in order to be a member. Yes, so this is giving an end to my presentation, and I'll be very happy to answer questions you might have. My feeling is that I'm quite sure this technology is fantastic, and the IEEE Power Electronic Society is trying to serve our members, so we are continuously moving on with making the power electronic and application technologies better. So so we are powering what we can call a sustainable future. And I also hope, if you are not, that you could be inspired to be a member of the IEEE Power Electronic Society. And if you are a member, I also hope and encourage you to volunteer and go up and do volunteer work in the society. So I think that ends my presentation. It does, and I will move back to you.
The question. Is there any Power Electronic Society volunteering committee? Power Electronic Society student members can directly work with rather than student branch chapters.
Could you repeat the last part
Sure. Is there any Power Electronic Society volunteering committee that Power Electronic Society student members can directly work with rather than student branch chapters?
However, so you can work with the technical committees, you can work with the young professionals, as I showed for you before in my slides, right? So this is a possibility to work with them. So this is something I will absolutely encourage you to do if you are interested to do that.
We've got a technical question. Right now, wireless power transfer is not showing efficient. Will it be useful in future?
The wireless power transfer is used today. As a mobile phone, you can buy where you transfer power. So despite the efficiency is not super, super high, it is applied already. So I think it's just to move on and see how it's possible to make the efficiency high. So it is applied. We cannot say it's not applied. Whether it will be applied in any kind, for example, electrical charge, vehicle chargers, or I think time will show what is. But absolutely, wireless power transfer is here. It will be used more and more, and we can say as long as we do not have an efficiency of 100%, we will all the time try to make it better.
Okay, sir. We've got another question. Yeah. Is there a community named Women in Power Electronic Society? And if so, what opportunities female volunteers have to take?
In general, females have the same possibilities for as male, so there are no difference. there has been a need in IEEE to put more focus on also women in general, because in some areas it's very, very little how much women are engaged. And women in engineering in the Power Electronics Society, yes, there is an organization where you can join. So this I will absolutely encourage you to do. You can mail to me, or you can mail to one of those six, and I'll give you some names who are in charge of that, and you can be a part of that. And that can both be, I think it's Catherine Kim now, maybe. It is Catherine Kim who is in charge of it. And there are special webinars, they do special things also to promote women for awards and so on. So yes, absolutely. Please volunteer.
Okay. There's another question asking, how can I join Power Electronic Society Young Professionals Committee? is it possible to join these days?
I think if you look in the slides, and I hope you are very welcome to distribute, you can see those names in my slides. And please contact them and say that you want to be volunteer. So you have the sites, right? So there were some names you can, and also PELS has a website, and that's the website. Try to go to the PELS website and look. And there you can also see the contact names. We try to keep it, all them updated as things are changing in terms of who are officers and so on. So yes, please go on.
Another question, how to apply to be a distinguished lecturer with Power Electronics Society?
It's called every year for that. So I think it's around summer. Calls are sent out for proposals. And then it's decided that the ETC North America, who is serving next. And if you are, as a previous say, it has to be IEEE fellows. As a who are distinguished lecturer. So this is as a, in the program as a, it is said that it should be some of our previous fellows. It could happen that it's not the case, but this is what we try to do. And then they are also welcome to mail to me, or and then I can forward it further to the people who are in charge of it. But again, the website is saying who is in charge of this program. And if you want to apply for a distinguished lecture to be held in Sri Lanka, then you then there was a, if you look at the slide, you can click and you can apply for that. Also on the website.
We have another question asking about the researchers. Researches happening in the power electronics field.
Yeah. And what research happens as well, in general?
This question is not very clear.
It's broad if we talk about which research are going on. I think my diagram you show, I showed the first diagram, I think it indicates a lot of applications are going on. So they go research from, small components, devices, up to big systems in the area of power electronics. We see being done a lot. So there are so many activities. Also, the technical committees, I think they indicate also areas where research is done. This is very broad. Fortunately, there are a lot of research going on.
Okay, I think all the questions have been answered by now. Okay, that's all for the Q&A. Thank you everyone for your interactive participation. We appreciate it. With that, we have reached the end of the webinar today. Therefore, I would like to invite Tasuni Vanidayaka, Secretary of IEEE Power Electronics Society, Srinivas Shastri, in the Moratuwa, to deliver the thanks to note.
Good evening, everybody. Yes, sir, and all the participants joining the webinar today. I'm Kasuni Vaninayaka, Secretary of IEEE Power Electronics Society, Srinivasan Chapter of University of Moratuwa, Sri Lanka. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Frede Blaabjerg, President of IEEE Power Electronics Society, on behalf of the Srinivasan Chapter, for all the cooperation with us to conduct this webinar up to this success. Sir, the content you presented today is highly informative and advantageous for all of us. And as far as I see, all this content enlightened all of us on recreating the path for leadership through IEEE PELS. So thank you very much for allocating your valuable time to bring us to light about the concept of leadership in this corporate world. And also, sir, I would like to be very glad to thank you for supporting us to initiate the first ever IEEE Power Electronics Society organizational unit in Sri Lanka. We proudly stand here as you lifted your hand to create the name of Power Electronics Society in Sri Lanka. Thank you so much, sir. So now I would like to turn towards all the participants of this webinar who joined in with the relief of experiencing an amazing webinar from Professor Frede Blaabjerg. Thank you very much for being supportive and considerate throughout the webinar and joining the event even under this COVID-19 pandemic situation. We hope to join with you again in another great event like this in future. And thank you so much and have a good day and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Kasuni. Thank you, everyone. I appreciate you being here. I wish you good health and safety. We'll see you again next time.
Thank you. Thank you for organizing and good luck with your chapter activities. And be careful.